Welcome, friends, to our NPTEL MOOC module on health economics. We are discussing one important dimensions of behavioral economics is noise theory. The meaning noise is very clear, very clearly understood with a kind of, you know, gesture, with a, you know, a very quick gesture, etc., a short term action, etc. We will clarify everything systematically. But what we did in the last lecture in connection with this lecture is that we started discussing the previous one on prospect theory. We have given all possible steps of the prospect theory, and hence the subsequent lecture should be on noise theory. So, I'll just introduce what is noise and who introduced, etc. Noise theory is a concept originated in the field of economics and psychology. It is popularized by Richard Thaler and Cass, you know, Sunsteins in their famous book called Nudge, Improving Decisions About Health, Wealth and Happiness. So, you must have understood or about some of the works of Richard Thaler. Richard Thaler is particularly famous in the present days because of the Nobel Prize he has received already, of his contribution in this direction. So, then what is nudge? It is, a nudge is any aspect of the choice architecture that alters people's behavior in a predictable way without forbidding any options or significantly changing their economic incentives. So, nudges are not mandates. To count as a nudge, the intervention must be easy and cheap to avoid. For example, we have already cited one simple case study, one simple example on consumption habit to develop through a nudge. If you put fruits at your eye level or eye count level, then this might be improving the extent of consumption of food as against other unhealthy, you know, products. But just by banning junk food, you know, to increase the consumption of healthy food like fruit is not called nudge. Okay? So, nudge is simply you are taking action positively, giving the scope to the individual to take a decisions quickly. That's like, you know, you are just keeping fruits in a very close distance in front of eye, and hence more chances are there to be consumed. Some of the other words which are quite frequently used in this context is called reinforcement. This is all about strengthening the likelihood of a future behavior. Positive reinforcement adds a desirable consequence, while the negative one removes an undesirable consequence which are associated with the behavior. The theory suggests that positive, you know, reinforcement and your indirect, you know, suggestions can influence people's behavior and decision making. All right, we have already used terminology called you know, choice architect, then architecture, etc. We are going to clarify this. Choice architect has the responsibility for organizing the context in which people make decisions. Whereas in case of architecture, choice architecture is related to libertarian paternalism and noise theory, which proposes that positive reinforcement and implicit suggestions can influence behavior. Noise theory emphasizes the decision of choices or choice architecture to influence decisions. By altering the way options are presented, the theory aims to guide individuals forward, making and better choices without restricting their freedom. Here we are giving, you know, six principles as per the original discussion by the experts, which we have already cited. We are saying that these six principles of good choice architecture are largely called nodges or mnemonic. They are actually just mnemonic, you know, just meaning and in a short form. Good architecture includes incentives, which provide right incentive to the right people to enable good decision making. Then understand mappings relate to, you know, consequences of different decision pathways. And there are defaults as well, like people, it's difficult to leave the decisions which are usually, you know, considered to be default. People often leave the default decisions on if they are too lazy to make a decisions. Then giving feedback helps improve the decisions, and expect, you know, error is the one where the error is human, and design should be built accordingly. It has a structure complex, you know, choices, then, you know, make the choice structure simple and convenient so that it should reach to the people for better decisions. Now coming to libertarian paternalism, this is all about the Norse theory, operates under the concept of libertarian paternalism, which means influencing behavior for the better while respecting individual's freedom to choose. Nodges are designed to guide your choices without imposing mandates. Libertarian paternalism is the idea that is both possible and legitimate for institutions to influence behavior while also respecting freedom of choice without, you know, any coercion. Hence, there are two cognitive systems, as discussed in the original articles by the authors, which are already cited. So, the two cognitive systems are like automatic or reflective. So, automatic, there are some features we'll discuss, and for reflective we'll also discuss. Just for your basic clarity, we want to refer here one example, that is, you know, most Indian people have automatic system reaction to a temperature given in Celsius scale, but have to use their reflective system to process a temperature when given in Fahrenheit scale. Similarly, speaking in native language, you know, it's an automatic one. While speaking in foreign one, we are supposed to get a reflective, you know, approach for, you know, understanding and taking a decision with another language. Hence, the difference between these two are, you know, like for automatic system, it is largely uncontrolled, effortless, associative, fast, unconscious and skilled, whereas in case of reflective one, it is largely controlled, effortful, deductive based, because you are supposed to deduct the information based on reflections or reflective, you know, approaches. Then it is relatively slow, self-aware and rule following. Then some other concepts are used in Norse theory are called heuristics. There are three heuristics or rule of thumbs, as proposed by Tabasky and Kahneman, 1974. Heuristics are mental shortcuts. These allow us to make quick judgment calls based on generalization or rules of thumb. And you know, heuristic can cause, you know, biases. Biases we have already discussed in our lecture. These are called optimism and overconfidence. Gains and losses, status quo bias and framing. We have already discussed, and you can follow the lecture accordingly. And especially in the previous lecture, it was discussed categorically. Coming to the three heuristics as proposed by Tversky and Kahneman, they are anchoring, availability and representativeness. And so heuristics are associated with biases, and both emerge from the interplay between automatic and reflective system. So, like in the case of anchoring, when estimating a certain value, we tend to give an initial value and then adjust it around that initial value, either increasing or decreasing. Similarly, regarding availability, our mental shortcut used to making frequency or probability judgments based on the ease with which instances or, you know, occurrences can be brought to mind. Judging the frequency of cyclones occurs in the Bay of Bengal, since, you know, we are more acquainted and more, you know, available to the people who are, you know, nearby or in the context of Bay of Bengal. They used to, you know, judge the frequency of cyclones more on the Bay of Bengal as compared to Arabian Sea. And another, you know, bias as of the heuristics are due to representativeness. We categorize events or objects based on how they relate to instances we are already familiar with. Okay, like, you know, category of dogs, you know, or category of chairs, category of humans, you know, there are some representations have already been made. You know, hence, we used to just, you know, be biased toward those one and simply, you know, view as if a representative one is being discussed. Okay. So, further details you can follow from the respective lecture. Here is a case study on nausea and health. We have taken from our earlier example as well on organ donation, opt-in and or opt-out, if you remember. Some systems have opt-in principle and some system have opt-out principle. But now we can understand which one has better notch. Okay. So, coming to the first one, you know, like called explicit consent, that is simply based on the willingness to donate. And it's called the willingness to donate, like you get the form filled through willingness to donate. If any accidents occurs or at the time of, you know, DL or driving license, if opt-in is taken, then that's part of, you know, willingness to donate. That's purely called explicit consent. Default rule is everyone has to register to donate. Then there are challenges as well. Inertia exert a strong influence. And there are suggestions like changes in choice architecture would help in ensure that more organs are available. Another one is called routine removal. Legally, everyone has to donate if simply asked. And the default rule is that, you know, everyone who is eligible to donate has to donate if that is made as a compulsion. Okay. Then that's precisely undermining the case of notch. And challenges are the, like, you know, it violates the right of people over their body. And the third one is called presumed consent. You know, it is considered to be, you know, a consent taken, just opting out in case of organ donor, like based on willingness not to donate or unwillingness to donate, etc. As part of the opt-out system, we have already discussed. So, default rule is that everyone is registered and are allowed to deregister. And there are challenges, no doubt best approach, this is the best approach, but often countries with presumed consent system have lesser organ donation count due to lack of infrastructure in place. And also it is politically not viable. Okay. So, the example you have cited and accordingly you can understand. So, where the nodes are actually working, okay, it has to be emphasizing the willingness of the people. Another one is on actually, you know, this also captures coming to the example of organ donations through the nodes, we can capture the demand supply gap in organ donation. I mean, these nodes are actually helpful enough to reduce these demand supply gaps. All right. So, in each of the cases we have started discussing, another approach to reduce this gap is through mandated choice. Since, you know, presumed consent method is politically and not viable, mandate choice ask, like, you know, during DL, registration for is mandatory. Then people, whether they are mandatory for the people who are willing to donate or not. It breaks the inertia. However, there's a default rule, like, you know, everyone has to register based on willingness to register. And there are challenges, it would produce fewer registered donor than a presumed consent policy. There are norms also. But before norms, let me just clarify that in case of this organ donation, freedom of choice and number of donations theoretically have negative correlation. However, with the right nodes and choice architecture, the gap in supply and demand can be reduced. So, some of the norms which are important, the state should give, prefer presumed consent or mandated choice systems on the grounds that either approach should be likely to save lives while also preserving the freedom. If both the cases are actually is taken together, it's really good. Web page should be there to attract donors in an excellent, which is considered to be an excellent one. So, if more information is given to attract, donors, would be a better notch. So, you can also refer our slide number 23, an introduction to behavioral economics. We discuss the role of behavioral interventions in organ donations. So, especially in the introduction of behavioral economics, we have already discussed. Coming to the significance of behavioral nodes is indeed substantial, as they can assist individuals and recognize their genuine preference for organ donation without biases. The opt-out systems have high enrollment for organ donation than the opt-in systems. We also discuss earlier. So, opt-out system where organ donation will occur automatically unless a specific request is made before death for organs not to be taken. Examples we are citing again, they follow opt-out system like Austria, Sweden, France and Russia. But in case of opt-in system, people have to actively sign up to or to register regarding this. Countries such as Denmark, Germany and US are following opt-in systems. So, these are the readings for understanding NOS theory. There are so many things to explain. I think these are the starting point we have given, and rest I am sure you will have interest to study. So, thank you.